I'm done begging. Done.
Begging.
Let me embody
the magic
that will keep slipping through your fingers.
Let me embody
the magic that will keep slipping through your fingers until you free yourself too. I do not want your privilege. I do not want your privilege. I do not want your privilege. I want both of us to be free.
Give me right. Or give yourself freedom. Give me right. Or give yourself freedom.
Take a left turn into our portal, into our portal, into our portal, so you can understand that there was never a right direction to start with. Give me right, or give yourself freedom. I'm done begging, done.
Begging.
Let me embody the magic that will keep.
Can everyone hear me? Brilliant. Platform is so honored to welcome you all to Dance the Guns to Silence 3, Healing Separation, Mobilising Desire. We are here tonight to honor the memory of the Ogoni 9 who were hung 25 years ago by the Nigerian military regime with Shell's complicity for resisting the destruction of their land and communities by international oil corporations. Ogoni in the Niger Delta is still devastated by the impact of the oil industry despite over 35 years of determined struggle. The long-fought for UN-led cleanup of pollution is stalled. Pipelines still cross farmlands and oil spills still blacken the creeks, while the oil companies are still pushing to re-enter Ogoni, which Shell was forced to abandon in 1994. The suffering of the Ogoni has not gone away, and nor will we. The same story is happening in communities around the world, including those organizing against fossil fuel extraction and pollution along the US Gulf Coast, in Mozambique, in the Albertan tar sands, in Indonesian villages destroyed by gas extraction, and the list goes on and on. This event today is in support of the Ogoni and other communities fighting extractivism around the world, coordinated by Platform in collaboration with MOSOP, the Movement for the Survival of the Ogoni People. The event will explore the situation in the Niger Delta within wider reparations movement and link it to British corporate power and the extraction and pollution impacts on ecologies and communities around the world. These situations can feel intractable, and traditional campaigning methods often run into the ground. In these conditions, creative, artistic, and cultural strategies can serve as a tool to tell truth to power, deconstruct the Western, colonial, and capitalist notions of existing, to reimagine alternatives. This is what we will be doing tonight. And to do so, we will all need to do three small things to hold space in the most respectful and generative way possible. We will listen to each other. We will try our best to assume the best of each other. And we will be aware of where our voice is coming from, of where your voice is coming from, especially when engaging in the chat and in the panel question and answers a bit later. This is a space where we aim to center and recenter voices that have been marginalized within mainstream and institutional climate justice spaces. Black, brown, indigenous, global South voices. Tonight is for us and by us. As Adrienne Marie Brown, brilliant activist and artist, has put it, it might be time for you to take up some space today. It might be time for you to give up some space. It might be a balance of both. And I trust each of you to find your balance. A quick run through of the logistics for tonight. There is quite a complicated process to enable as many people as possible to receive the content tonight. We have put in place live captions. If you go down on your screen, there's a little button written CC closed caption. By clicking on there, you should be able to enable subtitles. It's an automatically generated transcript, so it's not 100% accurate, but hopefully it will support you in holding the meaning. May that be required for you. We also have translation. Two brilliant translators with us tonight. David will be translating for us in Spanish, and Annick will be translating for us in French. If you haven't done so yet, if you go down at the bottom of your screen, you click right at the right of the bar, there is an icon with languages. It's by default switched on English. If you click on there, you can choose another language. May you wish to receive this event in French or in Spanish. David and Annick will do their best to translate some of the art pieces tonight. But as sometimes art speaks for itself, David and Annick will decide as and when and what translation is necessary. Pour la traduction française, pour ceux qui m'écoutent en français, parce que je parle aussi français, c'est le bouton tout en bas. Donc quand vous regardez sur votre barre de Zoom, vous allez tout en bas, il y a un icône pour le langage. Si vous cliquez dessus, et vous cliquez sur traduction en français, vous aurez la traduction française directement via notre traductrice Annick. Voilà, j'espère que c'est clair. If you encounter any issue with translation, we have a team tonight who is here to support. If you have any issue with translation specifically, please message Rose in the chat. So when you click on the chat, again, down at the bottom of your screen, there's a little button that says chat. When you chat on there, you can by default speak to all panelists. If you click on the cursor, the blue cursor, you can choose a specific person that you would want to speak to. And if you speak directly to Rose, R-O-S-E, she will be able to help you with any issues around translation. If you encounter any other tech issue, our colleague Ben will be able to help you tonight. And you can also message him in the chat. I put his name down in the chat. If anyone is showing disrespectful behavior tonight and disturbing the chat or the event, Rob and Ben, two other colleagues from the team, will gently warn you in the chat, warn any troublemaker, And if troublemaking behavior persists in the chat, we will gently, kindly, gracefully remove you from the space. This is just to ensure that everyone else who is part of this space and who wants to listen and who wants to learn can actually do so as safely as possible. I will now remind you what is coming for you tonight, a quick recap of the program. We will start with a 15-minute keynote speech and a 40-minute panel talk with four incredible speakers, which we'll introduce to you in a second. This will be followed by 30-minute question and answers. We will then dwell on some visual art and sound together to reflect and commune with each other to vision that future that the Ogoni Nine were fighting for, the future that many of us are still and will keep fighting for. This will leave us into a little interval, after which we will come back for a CCTV show, Continent Chop Chop TV, serving you decolonial capsules of movement, her story, hope and resistance. This will be hosted by virtual migrants, Suzanne Daliwal and myself. And before we start, I am going to introduce my co-facilitator tonight, Suzanne. My name is Laurie, and I am now going to introduce Suzanne, who will take us into our keynote speech and panel. Suzanne Daliwal, if we can maybe move to the next slide. Suzanne Daliwal is an artist, activist, and campaigner, working on climate justice, indigenous rights, and mining issues, listed as one of the most popular voices on the environment in 2018 by the Evening Standards. She is founder of the UK Tar Sands Network, which has worked for over a decade to campaign against corporations and financial institutions invested in the highly polluting Alberta tar sands. Suzanne has led high impact campaigns to shift the insurance sector from underwriting coal and tar sands projects and artistic interventions to highlight environmental injustice in the Niger Delta, Gulf Coast, and the Arctic. She has been working to amplify the voices of Indigenous delegations at the international climate negotiations and center the voices of Indigenous, Black, and POC voices in the climate movement internationally. She currently works as an artist, producer, writer, lecturer, anti-oppression trainer, and recently completed a research fellow at the University of Brighton examining race, media, art, and climate justice. Suzanne, the floor is yours. And I invite everyone coming after me to speak as slowly as they can, because it will help our translators. Suzanne, it's your turn.
Thanks. Hi, Laurie. Great to see you. Hi, everyone. It's really great to be here and to hold space together. And without much further ado, I want to introduce our keynote speaker, Ken Henshaw has been an incredible inspiration to the work that I've done. I met Ken working around previous anniversaries around the execution of the Ken Sarariwa and the Ogoni Nine. So I'm really, really happy to have you here today. And I'm just going to read a little bit about your bio because it's just so deeply impressive, the work that you have been doing. Ken is a leading environmental and social justice activist and director of We the People. And We the People works to provide platforms and spaces, especially for those at the vulnerable end of negative government private sector policies. And amongst that work, CSSD aims to research and identify best practices, policies, and alternative frameworks which respects the rights of community people, protects their livelihoods, serves the environment, and promotes their existence. CSSD works in solidarity with communities to identify, plan, and carry out solutions crafted by them and tailored to address their own needs. So with that, Ken, I would like to give you the floor and thank you for opening up a space for us.
Thank you very much, Susan. Thank you for that very profound introduction. And guys, thank you so much for putting this up. Normally, I'm a very fast speaker, but I'm going to try and slow it down as much as I can, you know, for the sake of the interpreters. And let me first say that this is a profound opportunity for me to share these thoughts. Share the thoughts because Ken Sarowiwa, I mean, I live in the Niger Delta. I've lived in this region. I share the same city his entire life. And I was a young boy in secondary school when the movement started and the government killed Ken Sarowiwa. And his life was an inspiration for me to get into activism. And it has remained a model for most of what I have done. So Ken was a unique character. He was a unique character. Unlike many people, like many great Bella, or Patrice Lumumba, and Frantz Fanon, he didn't set out to be a politician. He never did. His venture into political act influenced by the fact that he responded to the oppression of his people, an oppression that he fought, he mobilized his people to confront of this thing. So who was Ken? Ken was a young Nigerian. As a young lad, Ken grew up in his native Ogoni land, seeing corporate theft of the resources of his people. He grew up seeing Shell as an oil company endlessly extracting oil from his space, from his environment, and leaving the people in dire want. Ken grew up with environmental pollution. Ken ate yam and fruit crops that were poisoned by hydrocarbons. Ken, in his lifetime, saw his people, you know, sliding further and further and further, a kind of poverty that could have been prevented if just a little bit of the resources that comes from Ogoni land had been used to develop Ogoni land. Ken saw oil companies partitioning his native Ogoni land just in the same manner the Berlin Conference partitioned Africa to scramble for resources. Ken saw his native Ogoni land broken down into oil blocks. Villages and communities meant nothing to Ken. Ken saw his native Ogoni land described as an oil mining license rather than Ken Kana, which is the name of his village. That's what he saw. He saw different regimes in Nigeria, military regimes, fighting themselves and overthrowing each other just to get a share of the resources of the Ogoni people. He saw oil spill into rivers that made his people unable to fish. He saw oil spilled into the earth that made yams and cassava unable to grow. Ken lived through this. He saw all this. He saw his people continuously sliding into poverty. And he was a reluctant campaigner. He was forced. He didn't choose that path. He decided at some point that he could no longer watch the suffering of his people, and he decided to use everything at his disposal to fight. So what was at Ken's disposal? He was a profound writer. He was a poet. He was a TV producer. Growing up in Port Harcourt, I watched Bassey and Company. It was a weekly TV show that ran for about 2 years. Ken was a writer and a director, and he was good at what he did. He used his skills as a speaker, as a debater, as an artist, as a poet, as a writer, as a playwright. He used everything he had and deployed it into the fight for environmental justice. Ken responds to something that has continued in the Niger Delta for over 60 years. I live in the Niger Delta. The Niger Delta is a place where the people traditionally live on farming and fishing. And unfortunately, with the exploitation of oil, the rivers can no longer retain fishes. I live in the Niger Delta, a region where you go to a river in a place called Goi in Ogoni land, and you see a dead river. Now, I do not know if you have ever seen a river that is dead. It is a river with the colors of rainbow on it, caused by hydrocarbons, by crude oil. It's a river where nothing moves. There are no crabs, periwinkles, fishes. No life can be sustained in those rivers. In the Niger Delta where I live, you plant cassava and you go to harvest it. You pull out the stem from the ground and then you squeeze it, crude oil comes out of it. In 2011, the environment program decided, after a lot of pressures, carried out an assessment of selected in Ogoni, extent of hydrocarbon pollution in that space. They came to a conclusion that the report said that Ogoni land was so bad that it would take a minimum. The UNEP report also said that the water the Ogoni people drink was contaminated by a chemical element called benzene that causes cancer. 900 times report was released in 2011. This is 2020, exactly 9 years after. And the people of Ogoni land still drink the same polluted water. They still bathe in the same polluted water and they still plant in plants. Ken Sarawa's struggle was a radical marginalization of his people, but also the cultural exploitation of his people, makeshift building materials, where NGOs, non-governmental organizations, are the ones who provide healthcare, where the government has consistently failed to give back to the people. You walk into Ogoni land, there's no difference between Ogoni land and a war-torn, war-ravaged, forgotten place. Ogoni land is ravaged by poverty, destitution, and conflict. And this is the image of the entire Niger Delta. The state of the Niger Delta is that of destitution and poverty. Currently in Nigeria, unemployment rates in the Niger Delta is the highest in the entire country, despite the abundance of oil resources which the government takes from that space. Conflict is on the high, and it is, you know, one of the most devastated ecosystems on planet Earth. Ken Sarawiwa launched a campaign in the early 1990s demanding a better deal from the Nigerian state, demanding the respect of the environment, the respect of his people, the restoration of their dignity. The Nigerian government, working in very close alliance with the oil companies, especially Shell, decided that the best response to the genuine agitation of the people of Ogoni land was to silence the messenger. In 1994, Ken was arrested. In 1995, on the 10th of November 1995, Ken, alongside 8 other prominent Ogoni leaders, were executed. The story of the death of Ken is that of pain, you know, that of a terrible image of suffering. In fact, there's a report that they attempted to hang Ken a total of 5 times. And the machine, I mean, the hangman kept failing and he kept dangling, you know, for several hours before they finally were able to hang him. Despite the profound struggle of Ken Sarawiwa, which continues till today, 25 years after his hanging, despite the fact that the people of Ogoni land have remained on the trenches, despite the fact that they have continued to dance the guns to silence, daring corporate power, despite the fact that they have demonstrated the ability of an ethnic nationality to push back corporate power and keep big oil out of their place, the people still suffer the effect of the many years of environmental pollution occasioned by oil. But it's a work in progress. So what are the legacies of the struggle of Ken Sarawiwa? That struggle is what inspired a generation of fighters, a generation of indigenous resistance, not just in Ogoni land, but also in the Niger Delta. The fight of Ken Sarawiwa inspired a fight to end military dictatorship. It inspired gender equality in Nigeria, which previously was an unknown concept. It inspired the continuous call for environmental justice. Through the lens of Ken Sarawiwa and his struggle, his nonviolent struggle for people's power, we see a new movement arising in Nigeria. It is called NSAS. It is a group of young people demanding an end to police brutality, demanding an end to corruption, but not just that, demanding justice, economic justice, political justice, and environmental justice. But just like in the days of Ken Sarawiwa, the response of the government again has been to crush that dissent. But that's a conversation for another day, because people are rising and they're asking questions. But I think that through the struggles of Ken Sarawiwa, we see a new future, we see a new opportunity. We can actually, through the struggle, see and imagine, through his words and his lives, we can imagine a new world. A world where development and human progress isn't measured by how much and how fast we can extract, but how well we respect and protect nature. Through the struggles and through the eyes of Ken Sarawiwa, we can imagine a world without corporate military wedlock that kills and destroys the environment. Through the struggles and the life of Ken Sarawiwa, we can imagine a world where power truly belongs to the people. We can imagine a world where democracy means power to the people, power to all people, big and small, all ethnic nationalities, and not just corporate power. I will end this conversation by quoting the last speech, a part of the last speech which Ken Sarawiwa made to the military tribunal that sentenced him to death. He said, and I quote, "In my innocence of the false charges, in my utter conviction, I call upon the Ogoni people, the peoples of the Niger Delta, and the oppressed ethnic nationalities of Nigeria to stand up now and fight fearlessly and peacefully for their rights. History is on our side. God is on our side. It's been 25 years, but we are still dancing the guns to silence in the Niger Delta. Thank you very, very much for this opportunity."
Thank you, Ken. Thank you for being with us today and for bringing your powerful words. And however many times I hear the story, it never fails to move me and to reshape me and recommit me to this work. Thank you again. And now we're going to move into our panel, and we're going to continue the conversation. And before we do that, I just wanted to share some thoughts and reflections inspired by the story of the Ogoni Nine, and also how the work for environmental justice has moved me as well. And I just wanted to say that tonight is actually Diwali, which is the festival of light, which celebrates the triumph of justice over injustice, the revelation of truth over deception, and the welcoming of joy and connection, where we have faced separation and grief. And it is with that spirit that we join together this evening across oceans and time zones to spend some time together amidst such uncertainty and challenges unlike we have never faced before. As a campaigner who works to resist some of the most ecocidal and socially destructive projects on the planet, often we can be overwhelmed by the facts, the figures, the budgets, and political fatigue that comes from resisting capitalism, corporations, and colonial violence. And that's why it's so essential that we take time, like this evening, to pause, reflect, and understand where we have come from so that we know where we're going. And there's always something so powerful when we all bring our ancestors into the space together. And I say that because the struggle that we're in has been going on for 500 years now. Colonialism has simply changed its space. And now the colonizer takes the shape of corporations, capital, and a whole web of faceless contractors with families who are driving the death and destruction of vast territories. I spent the last decade of my life in the boardrooms of corporations, banks, insurers, and challenging the British investments that come from the likes of HSBC, Lloyd's of London, BP and Shell, the list goes on and on. And what connects the Niger Delta to the Athabasca Delta, where the tar sands are ravaging the landscape, is the same force of colonialism and corporate power. Today, I was remembering when I stood in the Shell annual general meeting, holding space for frontline campaigners to challenge the corporation year after year. And what we realized were our stories were the same. The capital and technology driving destruction was by being driven by the same powers of colonization. Except, as I said, the investments and projects expansions that were ushering in a rapid industrial genocide and ecocide. Corporations and financial institutions place themselves above the law of physics from and the violation of the law itself, from the violation of treaty rights, the undermining of local sovereignty, and the failure to secure the free, prior, informed consent that projects that happen on Indigenous lands. And that is what connects us all, those of us who are sitting in the UK, who are tuning in from other places, we're all resisting that force. And the need to stop the pipeline of capital that undermines that sovereignty. With all of these strategies, including divestment and pulling the plug on the money from British and major banks out of these ecocidal and genocidal projects, we must also think about what we're going to reinvest in. What is our vision for transition justice? How do we decolonize our strategies and ensure that the technologies and new economies do not replicate the oppressions which have led us to this crisis? This is where we must harness all of our creativity and take time with our movement ancestors like Ken and the Ogoni Nine to pause and reflect and see the wisdom we need to create the future. When I first learned about the work of Ken and the Ogoni Nine, I was a few years into working into the Alberta tar sands resistance. I remember finding one of his texts and sitting on the doorstep, just reading it, losing sense of time and place. It was the mentorship and comradeship I'd been needing. Nowhere else is the relationship between land rights, social rights, and the love of the land and art so central to anyone's works. And it was something I'd found myself fighting for so hard in the climate of environmentalism at the time. His love of pop culture, weaving drama and poetry sang to me. After years of being deep in technical campaigns, it was this enlivenment that moved me to sustain the work through the pain and difficulties of the work itself, as well as the forces we are resisting. 5 years ago, I was invited by Platform to support the 20th year anniversary memorial for Ken and the Ogoni Nine, where we planned to ship a life-size bus to Ogoni Land made by Sakari Douglas Camp. The bus read, "I accused the oil companies of genocide." It never made it to Ogoni Land. It was seized by the Nigerian government and we actually never saw it again. However, we worked with artists and activists to make sure that people knew about the bus. A slogan emerged, "You can stop the bus, but you can't stop the movement." Much like Ken said, "You can kill me, but you cannot kill my ideas." And tonight is a testament to that. The past few years have been some of the hardest in the climate justice work, as well as the mounting climate catastrophes, the global pandemic, and surging global fascism. We often have to face the perpetuation of oppression and lateral violence of movement in themselves. Our ecological and social justice movements have deep roots and teachings that we need to take the time to connect with, even though it can seem like an afterthought, to replenish our political and social beings so that we can actually navigate where we're going. This is when our creativity and our commitment to finding joy and pleasure amidst the chaos is of deepest importance. The creativity we tap into will help us lead the way. Despite the erasure we can often experience in mainstream environmentalism, the Ogoni Nine are our deepest teachers for how to fight for social justice and will show us how deeply it's connected to the way to climate futures. So that's just a few thoughts and reflections that I wanted to offer and that have been brewing as we've been working to prepare this. And now I want to transition to tonight. We're going to hear from some more of my dear friends and movement leaders who have been such a key part of the education and part of this movement, Her Story, for me. And I'm really excited to hear from you and your updates and what you've been up to, and so that we can make new relationships and community, even though we can't be in the same physical space at this time. So first off, I would really like to introduce Lazarus Tamana to speak first. Lazarus was born in Ogoniland, River States, Nigeria, and he came to the UK in 1980. He obtained a master's degree in corporate finance and administration. Having participated in numerous training programs for nonviolent and peaceful struggle, he became the president of MOSOP UK in 1994. I just want to say, representing MOSOP tonight. And he was the European coordinator of MOSOP for 23 years. And during the 1990s, he led a successful Ogoni and Nigerian campaign in the UK against the Nigerian government and the oil company Shell. And he acted as a European Union observer for elections in the Ogoni region for the 2013 Nigerian general elections. As an international activist, Lazarus is a defender of human rights and environmental issues and has delivered lectures and given speeches in many UK universities and colleges. Also at the UN in Geneva, London, Germany, Holland, and South Africa, Ghana, Uganda, Mexico, and Ecuador. And he's presently the president of MOSOP Nigeria. And you can follow Lazarus on at MOSOP Ogoni News. So thank you, Lazarus.
All over Nigeria. Come on. I heard the voice of the heroes crying out of the caves. What are my people doing? Are they fighting each other?
Stop. I think we are campaigning against the environment. We are campaigning against climate change, and it starts from here. We have been doing it for 29 years. Let's see what we can do together to rescue these people. Thank you.
Hello? Hello.
Hello, Lazarus.
Can you hear?
This is okay.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Right. That video was shot on the 10th of October last year. Just to highlight the situation that the Ogoni people have been facing and continue to face. Now, if you return back to that creek today, nothing has happened. The corporation called Shell, which was instructed to clean the environment of that creek, has done nothing, even after the court mandated them to go and clean up after the compensation that was paid in 2015. So,
It is the same story. Nothing has happened. Shell is not interested in doing the right thing. Not only that part of Ogoni land, which is border, the other parts of Ogoni are also under similar situation. It is a deliberate act by the oil company to ignore any voice of reason to do the right thing. And I can tell you, since I relocated from the UK in 2018 back to Ogoni land, because I wanted to witness and to see what I can do to change the situation, it has been the same story consistently. Shell, as we speak, are also planning to return back to Ogoni to mine oil on top of what they were supposed to do and have not done. The UN report of 2011 mandated them to start cleaning the Ogoni environment, but this has not happened. We have been hearing about cleanup, which they do on the pages of newspaper and on television. As far as the reality is concerned, we have not seen any effort by the oil company to do any cleanup in Ogoni, which has compounded the story for the ordinary Ogoni man and woman. It is very, very clear that we are drinking contaminated water, eating contaminated fish, eating contaminated food, inhaling contaminated air, and all those things, not to even mention about acid rain that is constantly available in Ogoni land. There are no available clean drinking water. If you need to drink clean water in Ogoni land, you have to buy bottled water for you to be able to do that. And how many of my people can afford bottled water on a regular basis? So they end up drinking the water as it is. And that, just of recent, when I was in London, that was in September, I put out a statement to Shell that they should come and screen the entire Ogoni people for hydrocarbon pollution. Shell utterly rejected that idea and said that they are not going to do it. They were asked to do it in 2016 after Mr. K came up with a report that the people occupying the creeks need to be cleaned, need to be tested for hydrocarbon pollution. And Shell rejected it. That was 2016. I have also made that appeal to them, 2020, and they utterly rejected. That means they don't have any indication whatsoever to change the situation of things and that. I think that we need to step up the campaign against Shell. They don't seem to understand that things cannot be business as usual. I know that they are heavily backed by the Nigerian government, whatever they are doing. And to some extent, the Ogoni elites that are supporting them. But it is the ordinary people that are suffering, who are feeling the pain of all these things. There is no way we can do it apart from activists coming out as they are always doing to question this multinational company called Shell. That is the only way out of it. We need to ask them, we need to put out questions to them. What exactly are they doing? 25 years down the road after the hanging, 30 years down the road after the formation of MOSOP. Yet this company don't want to look at the things that are real, or they are not willing to do the things that are right. This is the tail end of the anniversary, of the 25 years anniversary. Today is the tail end of it, that we are remembering these people.
Thank you.
Their loved ones, they just seized them away from circulation from their loved ones and everyone in Ogoni land. It is a very, very difficult thing for us, though we always remember them, but the circumstances under which they were killed is something that is painful to us and still painful to us till tomorrow. I thank all of you for coming out to support us. Thank you.
Thank you, Lazarus. It's always so good to reconnect with you, to hear that guidance from you and that call to action. And we send that out to all the activists who have been pressuring on Shell, and that at this time we can renew our efforts and to find ways, as well as calling for divestment, for reparations and for justice for the ecocidal and genocidal activities they are engaged in. Thank you again, Lazarus, for joining us this evening. And now I just want to let people know that there's going to be a chance to ask Lazarus and the rest of our panel questions. So if you want to pop them in the chat, we'll get to those soon. And now I want to move on to our second speaker, speaking of going deeper into understanding what reparations mean. I want to introduce Esther Stanford-Chosey, who's a leading reparations legal expert, an interdisciplinary law and history scholar activist, a public speaker, author and PhD candidate researcher in the history of the international social movement for African reparations. Esther is a modern day abolitionist and freedom fighter. She's passionate about law, justice and education, and using those tools in resisting forms of oppression and injustice. Her incredible work recognizes the harm caused as a result of slavery, colonialism, neocolonialism, racism, and the looting of resources. Esther's work focuses on stopping the extraction of wealth and resources today as a first step towards repair. Thank you, Esther, for joining us.
Thank you. And thanks to Platform, of course, for inviting me to be part of this very, very important commemoration. And I just want to begin my comments by also acknowledging the role of Platform in terms of internationalist solidarity, because that's so key. And when Ken Sarawiwa came to the UK, and obviously when he went back to Nigeria, and you know what happened back in Nigeria in terms of the persecution of him and the other Ogoni Eight, there were particular organizations and movements in the UK who played very significant roles. And of course, one of those was Platform. And another person and institution, I should say, that we should also recognize is the role of Anita Roddick and the Body Shop, because this is important when we're looking back 25 years on as to what role we all played or could have played. And I'm thinking in particular about the speech, the testimony that Ken Sarawiwa was prevented from reading at his military tribunal, and where he spoke about the fact that we all already are playing roles, and we choose the roles that we play in history. So it's important that we choose correctly, because history either absolves us or judges us. So I say that really to go more substantively into my comments that I want to share this evening in terms of some of the way forward at where we're at, and in particular how some of us as reparationists, which is basically reparations campaigners and activists, see the whole struggle of the Ogoni people for the restoration of their sovereignty as a people in Nigeria, and how this connects to the wider international social movement for African reparations. So when people hear the term reparations, they often just reduce a notion to reparations as being about financial compensation. And a lot of the talk about reparations in relation to Ogoni, the Ogoni people, other communities who've experienced historical and contemporary forms of injustice, often starts and stops with compensation. And compensation is important, but it's only one aspect of reparations under international law. And in fact, in the International Social Movement for African Reparations, we recognize two main frameworks, one being the Chimwezu framework. And Chimwezu, Professor Chimwezu, is a Nigerian public intellectual who at the first Pan-African Conference on Reparations in 1993, in a very famous paper, really defined reparations as being about holistic repairs. And this is self-made repairs on ourselves, mental, psychological, cultural, organizational, social, institutional, technological, economic, political, educational, repairs of every type that we need in order to recreate and sustain Black societies. He points out that more important than any monies to be received, and more fundamental than any lands to be recovered, is the opportunity that the reparations campaign offers us for the rehabilitation of Black people, by Black people, for Black people. Opportunities for the rehabilitation of our minds, our material conditions, our collective reputations, our cultures, our memories, our self-respect, our religious and political traditions, and our family institutions. But first and foremost, for the rehabilitation of our minds. He pointed out back then that the most important part of reparation is our self-repair, the change it will bring about in our understanding of our history, of ourselves, and of our destiny, the change it will bring about in our place in the world. And this is really key to envisioning a post-extractivist future that we all must be part of, not only envisioning, but shaping and bringing into reality. If we look at the UN framework on the right to a remedy and reparations, it recognizes that reparations has five key aspects. The first being a cessation of violations, assurances and guarantees of non-repetition. Then there's restitution. There are measures of compensation. There are measures of satisfaction, which is called symbolic reparations, and then measures of rehabilitation. So we can see that a reparatory justice framework is so appropriate to really looking at not only what we've heard about the current reality and what has been the reality in Ogoni land and other parts of the world that where people continue to be victimized by corporate power and the denial of their sovereignty. So we have to look at what is the way forward. And I'm really pleased to be working with people like Laz and others actually as part of the International Social Movement for African Reparations. Because in terms of the way forward and the way that was even articulated by people like Ken Sarawiwa, which is actually represented in this image that you can hopefully see on the screen, is it's talking about the restoration of sovereignty and actually political self-determination and autonomy for indigenous African ethnicities and nationalities that continue to be impacted by the structurally violent borders that were instituted in 1884, 1885 at the Berlin Conference. And we can see how that has particular dynamics and ramifications in the modern day country of Nigeria. So as much as we have to look at the immediate measures, which are actually stretching out now in terms of the failure to clean up, that is really the first part, the cessation of the violations and the assurances which must be provided. But the guarantees of non-repetition are how do we ensure that what is going on today and continues to happen, not just in Ogoni land, but in other parts of Africa and other parts of the global south where peoples of it have experienced colonization, how do we ensure that this never happens again? And this means fundamental systemic transformation and a redistribution of resources. So Ken Sarawiwa's vision was of an indigenous Africa united in Planet Repair's rebellion for global justice. And Planet Repairs are really the Chimwezu framework, plus looking at the environmental, ecological, and cosmological dimensions of repair. That was his vision that is still to be realized. The demands, the declarations, the aspirations, the visions that was contained in the Ogoni Bill of Rights from 1990 are still very much important for the kind of restoration of people. Now, finally, I think it's important to say the work, some of the work that some of us are engaged in, working with MOSOP and other formations, not only in Nigeria, but across Africa, in terms of looking at a campaign which is called Operation Wahala Nuse, and that is really pushing for a pan-African green economy and transformation. Because even in terms of what we're seeing with the contemporary campaign around end SARS, Nigeria, the youth of Africa need another way out. And we need to ensure that we can find prosperity for our people, but as has already been said, in a way that doesn't replicate those old systems of extractivism and domination. So that is what is being worked on today. And I'm glad to be a part of that.
Thank you so much, Esther. Thank you for that powerful ending. And thank you so much for grounding us back in the work that is happening on the ground at the moment. And we'll be sharing your bio and your handles. So we encourage everyone, keep following Esther on the socials, follow their work, find out more about how you can connect to this. And I just want to say that, just to echo what you said, that reparations are such the bedrock for how we transition as we move forward in this. So now we've been time traveling, and now as we dissolve borders, we're gonna also travel to our next speaker. This is Ilham Rawoot, is a climate justice activist working against corporate immunity with a specific focus on the oil and gas industry. She is currently the coordinator of the Say No to Gas campaign at Justica Ambiment, Friends of the Earth Mozambique. She previously coordinated the Southern African campaign to dismantle corporate power. She formerly worked as a journalist at the Mail and Guardian and Aban Ghani, the South African investigative journalist platform. And her most recent journalistic work focused on human rights and environmental violations by extractive transnational corporations in Southern Africa, abuse in religious institutions, sex work, and correctional centers.
Thanks, Suzanne. Thank you everyone and platform for inviting me and us at Justiça Ambiental onto this amazing evening. So I think I'm going to be talking about the gas industry in Mozambique. And I think beforehand, that would be great if the video that I'm gonna show you is just gonna give you an example of an idea where you can visualize what what the area looks like that has now been taken over by the gas industry, and then we can talk a bit more about it afterwards. So if you could go ahead and play the video.
Kuja na dalu nipani ngalini kifu eno bobo katambia kama ni sakwati modalini mulawepa moke mukavuo pande mwingine nguvu zile kwa nguvuni
no jwa musaire aki aulatu dimarche para la fora quasi 15 km como nós vamos conseguir nos trabalhar de lá para aqui nós somos pescadores.
Essa machamba pertence à família desde os meus antepassados. Essa área tem importância muito. Até nós aqui todos aqui confiamos nessa área para termos machamba. Toda a comunidade de Senga, as machambas deles estão aqui mesmo. Essa área que eles precisam.
Thank you. So what's going on in Mozambique, in Cabo Delgado right now is just continued, I mean, not just climate injustice, but climate racism. You know, it's textbook extractive, it's textbook Shell from Nigeria to South Africa, Mozambique, Latin America. It's that continued colonialism that comes out as we know what's good for you as developed countries. And by doing that, you know, continuing to hold Africa, and in this case Mozambique, hostage to this idea of foreign direct investment is the only way that South Africa, that Africans and Mozambicans can actually live decent lives, which is extremely racist. So this industry is headed up by Total, ExxonMobil, Eni, and the biggest buyers are Shell and BP. And some of the biggest financiers are, well, HSBC is one of them, and then a lot of state financiers like the UK Export-Import Bank, the US Export-Import Bank, then UK Export Finance just agreed to finance the projects as well. And what we see here is that with all these, so the communities that you just saw have all been, they've all been kicked off their land. So what you saw there, the village that was along the sea, that's now where an airport is being built. So the massive human rights violations caused by this gas industry are, like I said, the textbook, you know, people being forcibly removed, losing their livelihoods. The militarization that is coming with this is the same violence that we see perpetuated in this industry. So, and because there's so many companies that are involved and so many finances and so many states, they are able to not take any responsibility. So for example, at the Shell's AGM last year, the question I put to Chad Halliday was about why, you know, about everything that's happening on the ground in Mozambique and the fact that they are purchasing gas as, you know, the same thing we asked to HSBC about the fact that they are financing gas makes them equally responsible as any of the companies in this industry. And their response is always that we're not responsible for what is happening on the ground. And it's that complexity of this industry, it's that it's a spider web of companies and players, which enables them to, which makes it very difficult to hold them accountable individually. And this is one of the problems that we're facing, you know, is this lack of identifiability almost of these faces. So I'll give you an example of Shell, which is going to be buying 2 million tons of gas for the next per year for the next 13 years from Total. And Atradius, which is the Dutch state financier, is going to be financing them. And we've been talking to them repeatedly about why they shouldn't be doing this. And the response that we keep getting is from all of these players, not just them, is that Africa is corrupt. And whatever we do with our money, we give the tax that we give to the Mozambican government, all the laws that we abide by, it's not our responsibility what happens with the money. That is extremely racist because it's playing into a legacy of a corrupt legacy of colonialism and not taking any responsibility. Governments do not corrupt themselves. Mozambique is quite an interesting country because there were, a few years ago, there was an illegal debt scandal where $2 billion of illegal debt was taken by the government from VTB, which is a Russian bank, and Credit Suisse. And there are currently two Credit Suisse bankers in prison for this, the former finance ministers in custody in South Africa. It's corruption is notorious. And yet this idea of, you know, it's Africa is corrupt. There's nothing that we as developed country governments and developed companies from developed countries can do about it is it's insulting, you know, at best. And the thing is, by continuing to provide or by continuing to invest in countries where communities who are impacted by this, by extractives, and who are literally losing their lives, by continuing to invest in that when you in a country that is where people are clearly not benefiting from it, is enabling continued corruption, and it's rewarding this corruption and enabling impunity. So when, I mean, Mozambique is one of the biggest energy producers in Africa, and it's still only 27% of the country has access to electricity, which it makes it clear that extractives are not benefiting the people, and yet they continue and they continue to invest. And it's just, it's holding African countries hostage. You know, it's keeping us reliant on the extractive, on American and European companies to come and take from us, as we're held hostage to that as our only means of survival. And this is racism. This is a continued colonialism. It's a continued necessity to not be able to self, to not have the ability of self-determination as a people, not having the ability to decide what happens with what's underneath your ground and what's underneath your sea. It's the idea of you don't know, as Africans, you don't know what's good for yourselves. So this is something that we're seeing in Mozambique right now with this industry. And it's just what we're trying to do here is, because it's so difficult for people on the ground to actually stand up for you know, to actually resist the what we've been trying to do is take it to quite largely to an international activist group as a campaign. And what we find really helps is if the organizations that we work with buy shares in the companies that are involved and go to the AGMs and speak truth to this power and say to them, we know what you're doing, you can't hide it. Just because it's in Africa doesn't mean that we don't care. And this is something that we find is working, because when an African speaks to Chad Halliday at the Shell AGM, he doesn't listen as much as he would listen to somebody with a European passport. And that is something that we feel like people with European passports need to take a responsibility to assist or support the resistance of people in Mozambique to hold on to basic things like their livelihoods and their lives. So, yeah.
Thank you, Ilham. And yeah, just want to take a moment to thank everyone for your contributions, for all your knowledge of the impacts of extractivism, but also your deep intentional wisdom and understanding of how we can you know, get to the root causes of these issues and work together on this. So again, I want to thank you for taking time. I know so much of our lives is spent on Zoom, but I'm so grateful for you to come together to share what you understand about how we actually get to the future in both a concrete and a imaginative space. So I want to just remind the audience that we are taking questions. So pop them in the box and we will get them. And in the meantime, I've got some of my own questions that I want to ask. I wanted to first ask you, Lazarus, you know, given that we've all been seeing what's happening with the NSARS movement in Nigeria, I wanted to ask you, firstly, how we can act in solidarity with what is happening there, and also, how do you see the relationship between police brutality and the fight for ecological justice? Thank you, Lazarus. Oh, just have to unmute. Thank you.
Police brutality is what we have been experiencing over the years, particularly when we organize ourselves into forming MOSOP. The police have been going after us, and they have arrested us so many times, they don't allow us to do whatever we want to do. And we see that same pattern is what they are doing with the NSARS movement. And that what they have done in our own case is to brand us and call us all sorts of names and that. And we also saw that same pattern with this NSARS movement. Instead of the government addressing the issue raised by these young people, these revolutionaries, instead of the government looking into the issues they are raising, they are now branding them and giving them so many different names, and in some cases, freezing their account and doing all sorts of things to them, killing them, as we have seen, on the radio, on the television, and what has happened to many, 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 many young people. So that has been the pattern of the Nigerian government. That is the pattern of approach to these kind of issues, instead of confronting it and looking at solution that we solve what is actually wrong with the government and their approach.
Thank you, Lazarus. Thank you for taking time to expand on that for us. And I wanted to ask Esther a question now. You know, you spoke so incredibly about the field of work that is needed to be done for us to assure reparations. And I just wanted to ask you, for you, what is your vision of reparations? What does it smell like? What does it feel like in a world where we have the reparations that we desire and deserve?
So for me, it is really kind of very similar to Ken Sarawiwa's vision. As a reparationist African woman born in the diaspora, one of the key issues is around restoration of sovereignty, African sovereignty, identity, culture and personality, and the fact that we in the diaspora are dispossessed of our right to belong and our right to a homeland. And so even when we look at whether it's police brutality in Nigeria or in North America or even in Europe, the UK, what we see is that our lives will not matter because we lack global power. And part of the reason why we lack global power is because of the impact of colonization. And that has a particular dynamic for people of African heritage. So in the Stop the Mangamizi campaign that I'm part of, we see the vision is about a repaired Africa, which we refer to as Ma'atu Buntuman. And that's an Africa that doesn't have those borders of 1884, 1885. An Africa that actually respects the indigenous ethnicities and nationalities in Africa, and also an Africa that can incorporate her diaspora, truly incorporate. That doesn't mean we all physically go and live in Africa, but it means that we have a right to identify. But we know that our struggle is not a solitary struggle. We know that there are other peoples who've experienced colonization who are also wanting to transform their connections to each other, but also the lands in which they inhabit. And so we recognize that Ma'atu Buntuman has to exist in a repaired world, which we refer to as Ubuntu Dunia, a multipolar world of pluriversality and global justice that is based on Ubuntu, recognizing that we are people through other people, and our humanity gets determined by how we are able to not only relate to ourselves, but also others outside of our group. And so that is a continual struggle. And I believe that we will finally get there. And some of us are just carrying on the baton from previous generations who did have a vision of another world. And we know that this other world, as Arundhati Roy has told us, she's on her way. She's already here on her way. I think we just have to expedite it, her birthing.
Thank you, Esther. Very beautiful, powerful response. Our next question is for Ilhan, and it's come from our audience, it's from Mark Brown. What sort of cross connection and collaboration is there between movements in different African countries that are resisting extractivism?
Thanks, Mark. There's quite a good network of African organizations working together. So there are a few networks working on oil, on gas, on tax justice as well. And then for example, we're working with an organization in Uganda because we're called Afiego, and us and them and Friends of the Earth France are working together on Total, because Total has been active in Uganda as well, with a gas pipeline as well as in Mozambique. So we're trying to work together there as a group to see how we can bring Total to task for their work in both countries. And we work on finance by different banks in different countries. So we'd be working together with we'd work together on export credit agency financing of companies in different countries, and different finances as well. So there are groups of us that are working on different things. If you want to find out more, I can put my email in the chat, and you can just learn a bit more about the different movements that we have going on in Africa.
Great, thank you. And I also want to give Lazarus a chance to respond to that. And I just want to add another dimension to it. We have a question here from Manishta, and they asked, I was wondering if you could expand on any cross-border campaigns as well. There was a recent spill in Mauritius, the Chagos Islands, and is there an intersectional relationship, cross-movement solidarities that are happening with gender rights, LGBT rights in your work? So yeah, just wondering if there's any cross sections happening with your work with gender rights and LGBT rights work as well.
Well, we are trying to integrate so many of those into what we are doing at the moment. We are looking at a green revolution right across Africa with communities of resistance and other groups who can come together and challenge these things that has been a problem for us, particularly the extractive industry and those who are controlling everything and that. We are going through one at the moment with the ECOWAS, ECOWAS countries right across Africa, and we are linking up with others as well so that we can have this green revolution that will transform the current extractive industry activities into something else, because the extractive industry has not helped at all. And then the green revolution, if we can maintain that and link up with the youth across Africa and people, the activists, then this will create a lot of benefits for us. Whatever way you are looking at it, whether it is young people in West Africa, North Africa, Central Africa, and other parts of Africa, we just want to integrate this into all what they are doing and that, and linking up with save us, and then we will be able to work together to achieve something for the entire Africa.
Thank you. Thank you, Lazarus, for going deeper on that. And Esther, I just wanted to give you a chance as well to respond to that about the intersection of movements that you see emerging with your work across different struggles.
Well, reparations as a framework, as a policy, as a movement that is intergenerational, that is intercultural, and that is intersectional, actually is a foundational movement, okay? And so many different movements, campaigners with different social, ecological, economic, cultural justice struggles and struggles as so-called minoritized groups who experience different forms of subjugation and denial of self-determination are actually resonating with the reparations message. I think the key thing for me to emphasize is that there are many different reparation struggles. I'm part of the International Social Movement for African Reparations, which is very much concerned with the primary re-establishment of actually African sovereignty. Because you see, when we're denied, when we're losing our land, when Africa's being recolonized, when British companies, 101 of them, control, you know, trillions of dollars worth of Africa's key commodities, when we have Shell and Total and all these literally pulling the land away, you know, pulling the earth from under our feet and despoiling the environment, we have to focus on what is that primary struggle if we want to actually have a planet, and the planet repairs dimension is the one issue that we know unites all of us, whether we define ourselves in one way or another. So those solidarities are happening, but obviously it's always challenging to be able to integrate everybody's voices and to also amplify everybody's voices. But that's what movements are about. They are about struggle and contestation. And by doing that, we win.
Great. Thank you, Esther. Thanks for that. And I just wanted to amplify a comment that came from the audience that, you know, we're talking about this as we've seen that it's been queer Nigerians that have been at the forefront of the NSARS protests. So I'm happy to we can share some links about how you can direct funds and resources. There's some great fundraisers to make sure that we're getting resources to those front lines in real time as well. I'm just going to move on. There was a quick question around shares. How do you buy shares for some of these corporations? You can very easily get a stockbroker if you do it in a group. You can buy some shares, and you can also ask around. A lot of pensioners often were given shares in BP as part of post-war or in Shell, and you can be appointed a proxy, and you can go and attend the AGM. So there's lots of different ways that you can engage with these corporations, as well as, you know, doing some of the brand damage, some of the brandalism work, going to some of the cultural events, looking at those cultural interfaces as well. So that's just a quick response there. We have another question, and this is for all of you. How do you personally keep your hopes and morale up as you do this incredibly, you know, difficult and important work? So we can start with you, Ilhan.
Ooh, I needed a minute to think about that. Wow, I guess I think especially with working with people on the ground, seeing the, who are so afraid, seeing small victories that, you know, that they, that, so I'll just give you one quick example. There's a one of the communities that we were working with when Total was doing its, you know, free prior informed consent. They what they would do was they would get people from other communities to come in to sign a register, but there had to be a certain number of women that were there, and the women in the community absolutely refused to sign this register. And that was a kind of resistance that we had never thought of, you know, having not been in one of those communities ourselves. And just seeing this kind of, you know, this feminist powerful resistance with one action like that was, it's things like that that remind me that we are going to get somewhere. We are going to get somewhere. Yeah.
Incredible. Thank you. Lazarus, how about you? How do you sustain yourself through the work?
I am absolutely determined, because when I come home to Ogoniland and I see all these women, all these men, and some of them will ask me, how far is the struggle? Are you sure we're going to get something out of it? Or we are just wasting time because Shell appears to be overrunning us and all those things. And when they ask me those questions, it gives me inspiration to fight on. I always tell them, look, we are going to win. Just keep fighting. And now it is 30 years, you know. One of the things that actually took me back to Ogoniland is for me to steer this movement, this muscle, for us to achieve something within the next, you know, few years for these people. I am quite sure that with the way we are going and their help and all those things and that, we are going to achieve something. I always tell them that, look, we are going to fight non-violently and we shall win. And that gives me a lot of hope.
Thank you. Thank you, Lazarus. And Esther? Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry about that. For me, it's about staying in touch with ancestors and also learning, relearning and strengthening myself with the actions and the words and the stories, the testimonies of those who have gone before. So the video that I chose where I was reading, you know, from Ken Sarawiwa's speech that he was prevented from reading, that's what gives me strength and inspiration. Knowing that others have actually walked the path and they have suffered more and that they stood up so magnanimous, that really is something. And the other thing is about keeping connected to African heritage communities on the ground in Africa, which is my motherland that I, you know, I'm trying to get back to. Because when you are in touch with communities in and of resistance on the ground, you really do get a sense of your own role, but a global perspective on your condition and also your people and actually the rest of humanity. And I think it's important that we always look at ourselves in relation to what's happening to others around the world. Because sometimes we may think what's happening to us is so, you know, terrible, but when we really compare ourselves, we know that there's many others who may have less, but they are standing up dignified and resilient. And that really is inspiring.
Thank you, Esther. I think all of those things really resonated with me. And, you know, I've been working alongside some of you for almost a decade. And I think that definitely keeping that connection to ancestors. And I think, you know, it's something you said, Lazarus, around when we see what we're fighting for, and I try and take as much time as I can, which is difficult in COVID, to be with the land, to put my feet on the ground, to remember the joy and what we're fighting for as well. And that can be really difficult, given that we're in this context with the global pandemic and the coronavirus. So many of our strategies and ways of connecting to each other have really transformed. So I just wanted to hear from each of you a little bit about how do you think that we can continue to build solidarity and trust across geographies, across space at this time, given the current situation with the pandemic. What are some of your ideas and strategies around how we can do that? We can start with you, Lazarus.
As a matter of fact, this building solidarity across countries and across continent, it is extremely very, very important. Now, when we started the movement in 1990, we didn't have any space in Nigeria here to stay and do our campaigns. We took the campaign out of Nigeria to outside the country. And that was when Shell became extremely afraid and the Nigerian government became afraid that these people, they will ventilate the information outside Nigeria. And, you know, they started branding names and that. But the moment we link up with people in the US, people in the UK, people in Europe, there's some direction. Shell started being very, very serious with us because they didn't want those information to be distributed or ventilated in Europe, you know? So if we walk across continents, if we link up from Nigeria, from Africa to Europe, from Europe to South America, through Asia, and that there is strength in doing that. There is solidarity in doing that. The oppressors are afraid when we link up in those areas, because they don't want to know what they are doing in Africa. They don't want people in Europe to know what they are doing in Africa. They don't know people in Europe to know what they are doing in South America, or also what they are doing in Asia. But if we share information, if we link up so that we understand ourselves this, and then share information, distribute these things, information from one area is distributed and all those things, and that the oppressor would be afraid to stampede us in one. Anything that is coming out of Europe into Nigeria, they are afraid. And Share doesn't want information to come from Nigeria to Europe, where their seat of government is. When things happen in that way, they are very, very afraid. So all the activists linking up and sharing information and working together and seeing what we can do wherever we are, it gives us a lot of strength. And I will encourage us to be doing that. I just came back from the UK, where I attended the reparation march, and we were doing other things with Extinction Rebellion. And this actually made Cher to be very, very afraid. They are on the run in the UK right now as a result of that collaboration with other organizations in the UK, Stop the Manganese campaign, all these other ones that we, you know, with the Green Revolution we are talking about, and all those things and that. They are afraid. So we should keep on doing these things. We should keep on linking up together. We should examine what we are doing and link up, share information, and do that. That will help all of us as a team.
Thank you, Lazarus. That's so inspiring to hear how busy you've been throughout this time and continuing to build that relationship. And Esther, it'd be great to hear as well from you, specifically if there are any, you know, are there new strategies you've had to work with given the coronavirus, and any advice you can give to activists who are trying to continue their practice during this time?
Okay, thank you. Well, I wouldn't say necessarily new, but the challenge of coronavirus has been that we've not always been able to physically meet, and especially in the context of doing internationalist solidarity work, which I do not only via the Stop the Manganese campaign, but the Extinction Rebellion Internationalist Solidarity Network that connects to the network, a network in Africa that MOSOP is part of, XRAN, a network in Abya Yala, South America, so-called, and also a network in Asia. So what we've had to do is to strengthen our communications infrastructure in a way that we didn't have before. Zoom is one mechanism, but there are others. We've had to ensure that in terms of tangible support, that we can help kind of try and resource people on the ground to have access to forms of technology that help them communicate with the wider world. So phones and sort of other communications devices. We've also been much more connected in many respects because we've been able to receive a lot more content where people have been able to show us through the videos that they've taken, through videos they're making of what's happening on the ground. And we're able to use channels to amplify those voices in ways that perhaps we didn't do enough of before COVID-19, because we were just physically meeting all the time. But we are still through connections that we have with people that are still going and coming out of the UK and going directly into these communities. So there is still some direct connections which must still happen, because not everything that can be done via technology. So that is what we've been trying to do. And we've been had to be much more kind of consistent and strategic around how we communicate and the forms of communications that we have as well, in order to kind of keep connected. And this is really, really vital, not just in the context of COVID-19, but also in the context of the security of activists on the ground, who are increasingly from private military contractors and the machinations of these corporations, especially where they are gaining international solidarity support. So that's the other side of it that I think we shouldn't lose sight of. But what we've also seen is a number of killings, especially in Abya Yala and some parts of Africa, especially under the cover of COVID-19 restrictions to people's freedom of movement. And that is a huge worry.
Thank you. Thank you so much for bringing that important dimension to this around, you know, the increase of violence given the pandemic and how the pandemic is being used to, you know, perpetuate land grabs as well. That's a really important point to make about that. Ilham, do you have any brief responses to that about some of the strategies that you've been using? And you're on.
I mean, I agree with, like, it's about making the facilities that we use, the digital facilities that we use, like Zoom phones, available to the communities who also, you know, who should also be having this ability to engage and sort of have digital campaigns as we're doing now, you know, that we haven't really been doing before. But I also think, yes, like people, you know, being murdered by mercenaries and the military in Mozambique that we're not hearing about very much. I think it's really important that people, now more than ever, that people in Europe and people in the US and people who have access to companies and whose voices are heard by companies that would not be listening to somebody in a rural community in Mozambique, firstly because they could hardly ever get their voices heard, but now because of COVID it's pretty much almost impossible to get the stories out there. I think that there's a responsibility that comes with, if you're somebody who is curious and knows what's happening, like, you know, you're hearing what's happening, you're finding out, like, through the alternative media and activists about what's really happening on the ground in Mozambique, for example, that you take the privilege that you have to share that with stakeholders and shareholders.
Thank you, Ilham. Thank you again to all of our panelists, and I just wanted to sort of hold all of that information and, you know, all of the insights and all of the context that we've heard from today, and think about the fact that, you know, the reason why we do this, why we spend time to hear our struggles side by side, to hear about the context, and that is so that we can then shift modes and to hold that knowledge, to hold that information, and to transmute it and alchemize it, and to move it into all of the ways that we can resist, that we can be in sort of enlivened by the different strategies that are happening in different spaces. And also to think about how can we come into community with people that we haven't had the chance to do that before. So I just want to give one final thank you to Esther and Lazarus and Ilham for joining us. And I want to say that, you know, now we're going to sort of switch gears a little bit. We've been healing the separation, we've been bringing ourselves into the space together, and now we're going to sort of start mobilizing our creativity and mobilizing our desire and visions for what that future can look like. And so I want to sort of think about, you know, how do we take all the strategies that we've heard, and how do we think about and visualize the way that we're going to bring that all together. So I'm going to pass over to Laurie, who's going to take us into this second segment of the evening. And we're going to kick off with some slightly different modes of taking this into our imagination.
Hello. So in the preparation to this event, we have commissioned some visual art. It was initially meant to go on billboards in London and Birmingham around the headquarters of HSBC, British Bank, which is still funding Shell to this day. And we also wanted to put these billboards up in London next to Shell's old headquarters. Fortunately, lockdown happened, but we're really happy to be revealing a billboard artwork that was created by Cheesy. Cheesy is a Nigerian art director, visual artist, and textile designer. You have all of their socials here. And we asked Cheesy to make art that would allow us to connect to what happened 25 years ago and to really remember and commemorate the depth and the tragedy of what happened 25 years ago, as well as to create another piece alongside that one that would enable us to connect to where we could be 25 years from now if the course of action was to radically change. So this is the first artwork that was made from Cheesy, which was supposed to go on a billboard, and we have some context from them. This piece illustrates some of the devastating effects of Shell's presence and oil drilling in Ogoni land. You can see images of protesters condemning the environmental pollution, degradation, and deaths of people caused by the oil drillings to honor the Ogoni Nine who were killed for leading the protests. Boatmen, water fetching, and a water prohibition notice highlighting the breakdown of the healthy relationship that Ogoni people had with their water. You can see the flag of Ogoni land and a layered background illustrating the lush vegetation and rainforests native to Ogoni land rivers state. And before, we're gonna now basically take you to the next slide where you will see on the left, the image that represents where we were 25 years ago. And on the right, you have this image representing where we could be 25 years from now if British banks, British capital, if capital, full stop, colonial capital, started funding a future where all of us can actually live and thrive. This piece, the future piece you can see on the right, illustrates what could be indeed 25 years from now with investments against the degradation of Ogoni land. Freshwater boats filled with palm fruits, coconuts, melons, and palm trees, all native to Ogoni land and life, accompanied by images of young people jump diving, playing, and embracing each other. On the package that reads fresh air to signify that clean air would then be available. Ideally, this would be the future. Ogoni people enjoying their home, prioritizing leisure and healthy landscape, enjoying the fruit of their land. And basically, my invitation for all of you, is to take the next 7 minutes before we jump into the second part of our show, which will be full of performances and full of poetry and full of dancing. I want you to dwell there for a second. We're gonna play a soundscape to you, which is a soundscape I made in Creole. And it's a soundscape for us to dwell on the magic and the grace of our social movements as we keep carving out these better futures, these better worlds into our doing. I'm going to leave you there and we'll all be back at 9 p.m. sharp for some performance.
Hi.
Let's play that again. No, before.
Your point to say. Greetings, everybody. Welcome, welcome to Continent Chop Chop TV. So this is a cross-continental chop of creative climate justice content. And it is hosted by myself, Cy Murray, together with Suzanne Dhaliwal and Laurie Montpellat. Coming up on this first segment of the CCTV show, we have a selection of chopped, clipped climate justice creations of poetry, song, music, theatre, dance, and love, featuring the Nigerian poet and activist Nimmo Bassi, the beautiful, powerful Black women and femmes vocal collective Nawi, improvised interpretive dance from Akeem Toussaint book, all brought to you by a variety of collaborative climate justice connections. With Virtual Migrants, Voices That Shake, Platform London, the Black Activism Map, Globe Poets, Interdependence Festival, the Stuart Hall Foundation. But first, we begin the show with a short excerpt of the Virtual Migrants touring production, Continent Chop Chop, featuring the UK-based Nigerian heritage poet and Sheikh family, Selina Nwulu. Mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2.
One, two, three, four, five. Once we caught our fish alive. Six, seven, eight, nine, ten. We let them go again.
Remember when our Delta waters were clean? How we washed our faces in rivers and chased fish with our bare hands. Remember, before Delta had its throat slit and bled its oily pipes into soil, when we hummed words into water and it would laugh and sing back.
Six, seven, eight, nine, ten, we let them go again. We fed, bit us, took our fish, processed our waters, coated us in breadcrumbs, and fed us back our own fingers.
We are burning alive in this village. The oil pipes spew open like bowels and stain our homeland with curses. Our mouths become coated in oil. Drops make liquid nooses around our necks and our words buried and left for remains. We will never speak the same again.
On one hand, we have a fish. On the other finger. See, in this scenario, are we the fish or the finger? Do we bite the hand that feeds us, feeds lies to us? The other hand behind the back, like a bludgeon, mallet.
Look how abased the ocean has become. The waves ingest my fertile land vicious and devour my home to its bones. The ocean leaves its offcuts when sated, and I am left a half-lit emblem. Tell me, where does one turn to when their home becomes a hostile lover?
Teach the men, women, children, that this fish was their fish in the first place, our collective habitat, Halliburton, their Halliburton. And we will all eat for more than one day.
Remember when our Delta waters were clean?
Flying above our planet, you may pause. How fragile? Where are the borders, walls? Shudder. Someone has left the gas on. Are those candles for the Ogoni Nine? An eternal smogged flame for Sarawiwa. Bonfire fury, night and day. Protest hung where maps are drawn and village quartered. Black death spawns a white savior virus. Locusts take air, buzz over brown mouths. A bread basket is branded basket case. Feed the world with helpless, needy Africans. Do we know? It's 31 shopping days until Christmas. How much a pith helmet spacesuit? So talking of feeding the world, in this next clip, we welcome Nimmo Bassi, the author of To Cook a Continent, Destructive Extraction and Climate Crisis in Africa, as well as many other books and texts. Nimmo is an outspoken, active, and engaged Nigerian poet, writer, architect, activist, and a lovely man. And he has been a long-standing voice against climate destruction and calling powers to account. So here is one of Nimmo's specially commissioned poems recorded for Continent Chop Chop.
I'm going to read a poem titled, I Will Not Dance Your Beat, written in Cochabamba during the People's Summit on Climate Change and the Rights of Mother Earth in 2010 after the failure of Copenhagen. I will not dance your beat. I will not dance your beat if you call plantations forest. I will not sing with you if you privatize my water. I will confront you with my fist if climate change means death to me but business to you. I will expose your evil greed if you don't leave crude oil in the soil, coal in the hole, and tar sands in the land. I will confront and denounce you if you insist on carbon offsetting and other do-nothing false solutions. I will make you see red if you keep talking of REDD and push forest communities away from their land. I will drag you to the climate tribunal if you pile up ecological debt and refuse to pay your climate debt. I'll make you drink your own medicine if you endorse genetically modified crops and throw dust into the skies to mask the sun. I will not dance your beat unless we walk the sustainable path and accept real solutions and respect Mother Earth. Unless you do, I will not and we will not dance to your beat.
Nimmo Bassi there, correctly calling out and identifying Mother Earth's would-be assassin, reminding us that we know the enemy's shame. So these poems have been brought to you by the countless number slain and the letter C, 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 T, V. Chattel, colonialism, neo-colonialism, corporatocracy, consumerism, civilization, Columbus, Churchill, church, conquer, cut, crusade, coerce, corrode, Coca-Cola. Let us speak the devil's name and free ourselves from prison. ca, cap, capit, capital, capitalism. As Nimmo notes, that poem was written in 2010. This next poem was commissioned by Platform in 2015 to mark the 20th anniversary of the murder of the Ogoni Nine and marking the journey of Sukari Douglas Camp's battle bus to the Niger Delta. Return. The bus ticket reads, return. Back to where you came from. How far is this journey for us to return to the origin of things? To return to a time before monocrops of concrete and glass punched skyward, fertilized by African blood. This journey begins with libation, a baptism of water, fire, burning free, remolding, rising again. We have been here before. Ocean and air breathe these deaths. Breathe these deaths. Breathe.
Breathe these deaths. Steel sinews hold muscle memory. Ecosystems oil the engine. The wheels on the bus go round and round, round and round, and crack and judder and round. Click, turn, crunch, grate, burr, crash, drive. Chain, stroke, chain, stroke, whip, whip, drive.
Turn,
break, whip, break, crunch, burr, crash, drive. Chain,
burr,
chain, stroke, whip,
crash,
whip, drive.
Drive.
On the bus, go round and
chain,
round.
Stroke, chain,
go round and round,
stroke,
round and round,
whip,
round and round.
Whip,
go round and round,
drive,
all day long. Wheels on the bus,
turn,
go round and round, round.
Click.
And round, round and round.
Great.
On the bus go round and round, oh,
crunch,
long,
crash.
Wheels on the bus go round,
drive,
and round, round and round, round and round.
Chain.
On the bus go round,
stroke,
round, oh,
chain.
Night, time,
stroke,
traffic,
whip,
whip.
Directed,
drive
into open waters, blind
turn,
alleys,
click,
overboard, underboard,
great,
above, board,
crunch, burr, crash, drive.
The bus will be departing at
chain
sometime today.
Stroke.
Sometime tomorrow.
Chain.
At
service
convenience to our decolonized flocks.
Whip. Drive.
Crawling at all points from
turn.
Black Lives Matter.
Click.
To transatlantic triangle.
Great.
Connecting Bristol.
Crunch.
To Montgomery.
Burr.
To Alexandra.
Whip.
To Ogoni.
Drive.
The wind.
Chain.
Whispers.
Stroke.
Return.
Chain.
Head.
Stroke.
Looking backwards.
Burr.
Burr.
Crash.
forwards,
drive,
return, back,
turn,
to where,
click,
we,
great,
came, from,
crunch,
burn,
crash, drive.
So again, they cannot stop the bus. They can stop the bus, but they cannot stop the movement. They try to sever us, dismember us, but we remember. And in the spirit of Sankofa, moving forwards, but honoring and building on the work of what has gone before, we invite you all to remember with us. So we invite you now to enter names into the chat of our freedom fighting family to remember. That could be our global family. It could be people we've mentioned today. We're here obviously to commemorate and to remember the Ogoni Nine. So all their names, all the names of the freedom fighting climate justice warriors and pioneers who have made it possible for us to be here in this space today. It could be your immediate family. But as Audre Lorde reminds us, we were never meant to survive. So we must also take a moment to remember how we got here. I know that Sister Esther Stanford Jose is part of a project called I Am Witness, which is a reparations project, which really documents the history of the survival of us as a people, as a global family. And this is so important when we have oral histories, we need to also document and to share our stories. So thank you for the names we see coming through now. And let's all take a moment. If we're not typing the names, we can engage in thoughts of people who were maybe not here. We can take a breath and just maybe close our eyes and to just think, take a breath for ourselves in this moment, for being here right now, what this moment means to us. Take a breath for those who are not here, haven't been able to make it today, but are with us always in our thoughts and in spirit. Take a breath to remember family. Thank you for those names. We can keep those names coming, and you will keep those names alive. And I'm sure we will keep those names strong in the struggle. And as again, Esther reminded us, and other people have said also, this is why we are here. This is where we take hope from, that we stand on the shoulders of our ancestors. And it's our duty to continue the fight and to do this work. So now we are going to close this first segment of CCC TV, and we're going to take you to the dance, to the song, to the joy, which we need to be reminded of, especially in these times, at all times, in these distance times. And this next film is from Voices That Shake, from the Nawi Collective Globe Poets, and it speaks to the power of connecting, the power of dance, movement, embodying knowledge through art, communicating, connecting through embodied art, through healing and repairing. As our artistic ancestors remind us, a revolution without dancing is not a revolution worth having. And when the music hits, we feel no pain. Salute, Robert Nesta Marley. And let us remember that we will not dance to their beat, but we will dance the guns to silence.
Well, before it gets packed, now I'll be sprinkling gold dust on the dance floor, challenging body movers to musical duels, drawing out swords with horizontal steps. I know my shaki will protect me. We tell the OGs, do your dance.
There were Africans in Britain before the English. So how far do we go back? Septimus Severus? They try to sever us. But these are not strictly straight Roman roads. This, the African circular, non-linear, traveling with Ubuntu in hearts. Journey towards Ma'at. Breathing, balancing, rematriation, reorientation, remembering, repping, repairing the road.
Hello, welcome to part two of the CCC TV show. I'm here tonight with Suzanne, and we're about to present you some frontline reports.
Hey, Laurie, thanks. And yeah, CCTV is crucial for keeping media moving forward. The mainstream media would have you think that the climate movement was invented 2 years ago, but with digital media, it's really important that we keep the frontline stories coming forward. And so without further ado, we'd like to bring you some reports from Melina Lubica-Masco, who's been resisting the tar sands, and also Dallas Goldtooth, who's with the Indigenous Environmental Network.
And before we do that, we are gonna go first to Martinique with a frontline report from Canel, who is a decolonial ecology campaigner, documentary maker. She has been working on a documentary called Let's Decolonize Ecology alongside Annabelle and Jeremy, two other decolonial ecology campaigners based in France. She is also correspondent for the Poisoned Martinican Workers Collective, and she will be telling us about what's happening on the front line of environmental racism in Martinique. We're going to the next slide. Oh, and after the video from Canubis, we'll have a quick video that basically documents the struggle, the environmental and anti-racist decolonial struggle in Martinique right now, to illustrate some of the themes that Canel will be telling us about before we move on to our two other reports. We can play.
Les 9 d'Ogoni ayant été assassinés à la suite d'une lutte environnementale et anticolonialiste menée contre la politique extractiviste menée par Shell, qui est une multinationale, et par l'État nigérian, je ne peux que me sentir connectée à ces crimes contre l'humanité, parce que en Martinique, nous luttons non pas contre un nouvel envahisseur, mais bien contre les conséquences de la colonisation qui remonte à 1635. Les descendants des maîtres esclavagistes en Martinique, que l'on nomme les béquets, grâce au soutien de l'Union européenne et de l'État français, mettent en œuvre une politique agro-extractiviste qui vise à produire des bananes, de la canne à sucre et des ananas qui sont destinés à l'exportation vers l'Occident. Cette politique agro-extractiviste, elle est extrêmement néfaste pour l'environnement et surtout meurtrière pour les populations martiniquaises et guadeloupéennes. Depuis les années 60, ce sont pas moins de 62 produits phytosanitaires, tous plus toxiques les uns que les autres, qui ont été utilisés dans les bananeraies. Pour certains d'entre eux, au vu de l'état de la science, on connaissait leur toxicité aiguë. Et pour autant, pour ce qui est du chlordécone par exemple, ça n'a pas empêché l'État français de délivrer des autorisations et des dérogations pour permettre leur usage au profit des becquets et au détriment des ouvriers agricoles qui, jusqu'en 1974, ont été contraints d'épandre tous ces produits toxiques à main nue sans aucune protection. Et qui d'ailleurs, jusqu'en 1974, ont été réduits quasiment en esclavage, ou en tout cas, c'était une situation qui se rapprochait du servage. En 1974, les ouvriers et les ouvrières agricoles se mettent en grève, et parmi les revendications formulées par les ouvriers et les ouvrières agricoles en grève figurait la cessation de l'utilisation de tout produit phytosanitaire, et ce dès 1974. Au cours de ce mouvement social, deux grévistes ont été tués par la police coloniale sur ordre du becquet Monsieur Aubéry. Aujourd'hui, les ouvriers et les ouvrières agricoles ainsi que leurs descendants meurent dans des conditions absolument atroces, tour à tour. 92% des Martiniquais et des Martiniquaises et 95% des Guadeloupéens et des Guadeloupéennes sont contaminés au chlordécone. Nos terres sont aussi contaminées au chlordécone et le sont pour plusieurs siècles durant, jusqu'à 700 ans selon le profil des sols. Nous perdons toutes et tous des proches qui décèdent de cancers, de maladies neurodégénératives et d'autres pathologies en tout genre. La Martinique est d'ailleurs la région du monde qui détient un record absolument moribond puisque c'est la région du monde où on enregistre le plus haut taux de cancer de la prostate. Depuis plus d'un an, les militants et les militantes martiniquais et martiniquais se mobilisent pour dénoncer cet empoisonnement et cet écocide en bloquant les hypermarchés détenus par Bernard Ayot, dont la famille est l'une des principales responsables de ce scandale, et Bernard Ayot qui, aujourd'hui, empoisonne encore les ouvriers et les ouvrières agricoles sur les exploitations bananières qu'il détient et que les membres de sa famille détiennent. Pour protéger les intérêts de la famille Ayot ainsi qu'étouffer ce scandale d'État qui coûtera très certainement des millions, sinon des milliards à l'État français s'il daigne rendre justice et accorder des réparations aux Martiniquais, Martiniquaises, Guadeloupéens et Guadeloupéennes, pour étouffer ce scandale, l'État français met à l'œuvre une politique extrêmement répressive et donc les procès politiques se multiplient. Plus d'une dizaine de militants et de militantes sont aujourd'hui poursuivis par la justice française, dont les 7 d'Océanis, ainsi que Denzel, Loulou et Isaïe, qui tous trois ont été condamnés à de la prison ferme, respectivement à 7 mois, 1 an et 7 mois de prison ferme. Lorsque ces trois militants ont été placés en garde à vue, une manifestation a été organisée en face du commissariat de Fort-de-France. Au cours de cette manifestation, Kezia, l'un de nos militants, jouait du tambour pacifiquement. Les gendarmes ont alors décidé de s'en prendre injustement à Kezia et de l'enculer, comme ils le disent si bien. Kezia a donc subi des tortures de la part de gendarmes venus d'Hexagone et ces mêmes gendarmes ont exprimé la volonté de le tuer en lui assénant des coups. Le procureur de la République, Renaud Godel, a monté un dossier de toutes pièces pour poursuivre Kezia, dont le procès devait se tenir aujourd'hui, à savoir le 9 novembre, mais ce procès sera reporté au 17 mars. Aujourd'hui, les gendarmes et policiers auteurs de ces actes de torture et de barbarie sur Kezia sont toujours en exercice. La France se présente comme le pays des droits de l'homme, mais ces scandales en chaîne démontrent qu'elle ne considère pas ses ressortissants et ressortissantes martiniquais, martiniquaises et guadeloupéens et guadeloupéennes comme tels. Les privations de liberté arbitraires, les traitements inhumains et dégradants, les actes de torture et de barbarie, la violation de nos droits à la vie et à la dignité, de notre liberté de manifester et de notre liberté d'expression prouvent que la France est encore prête, malgré l'abolition de l'esclavage, à faire couler le sang et les larmes des Noirs pour préserver les profits des becquets, pour maintenir un système économique factice qui repose sur la monoculture de la banane et de la canne à sucre. Donc, si l'esclavage a été aboli, finalement, ces symptômes subsistent. Aujourd'hui, des musiques, des documentaires, des peintures, des dessins, des performances sont réalisées par des artistes ou par des militants, tout en sachant que bien souvent ces deux qualités se recoupent, pour passer par d'autres vecteurs de dénonciation que les modes de participation politique conventionnels comme les manifestations ou par des actions plus radicales, pour pointer du doigt cet empoisonnement général et la répression qu'appelle sa dénonciation. Le but, c'est aussi de sensibiliser un plus large public puisque l'art transcende les frontières. il est aussi question, je crois, d'exprimer et de traduire sa peine, sa colère et sa révolte, plutôt que de les ruminer et de les laisser nous consumer depuis l'intérieur. L'art est aussi un moyen de soigner les âmes, à défaut de pouvoir soigner des corps qui sont malades et ou mourants. Même si l'art à lui seul ne permet pas d'obtenir justice, en tout cas il y contribue, puisque c'est une composante essentielle de la lutte, lutte qui d'ailleurs est un art en elle-même. Même si on aimerait bien pouvoir se passer de cet art, mais s'en passer signifierait que œuvre de justice aurait été faite. Les 9 d'Ogoni ayant été assassinés à la suite d'une lutte environnementale et anticolonialiste menée contre la politique extractiviste menée par Shell, qui est une multinationale, et par l'État nigérian,
This video was sourced from the social media accounts called Justice for Kezia. There's a big campaign now organizing for this young man who's been on the front line of racism and police brutality around the resistance of this movement against that land poisoning, which in many ways resonates with the sort of land poisoning we've been talking about earlier today around oil. And I'm going to now pass on to Suzanne so that she can introduce our two next frontline reports for the evening.
Thanks, Laurie. Just wanted to say that this evening we're connecting from the Delta to the Delta, from the Nigerian land spills and waterways that have been devastated to Alberta, to the tar sands that have left an immense scar on the land, which will possibly never recover in our lifetimes. Our next two reports are from two dear friends that I've been working with for over the last decade and to resist what is happening there. Many of our speakers spoke about the role of international solidarity, and core to the work that we've been doing has been to internationalize the devastation in the Alberta tar sands that has been led by Indigenous women. And as I mentioned before, often our movement, her stories and the way the media works, we can lose the narratives, we can lose the movement leaders who have been working so diligently behind the scenes. So Melina Lubicon-Massimo is Lubicon Cree from Northern Alberta. She's the founder of Sacred Earth Solar and the campaign director at Indigenous Climate Action. She's also a fellow at the David Suzuki Foundation with a clear focus on climate change, Indigenous knowledge and renewable energy, and also the host of a recent TV show, Power to the People TV. And then our following clip will come from Dallas Goldtooth. Dallas Goldtooth is first and foremost an absolute comedian. And he's also the organizer for the Keep It in the Ground campaign at the Indigenous Environmental Network. And if you want to check out some comedy, look at the 1491s. Here we go.
Hello, relatives. My name is Dallas Goldtooth. I'm a Dakota man from the Dakota territories here within the so-called United States of America. I'm an organizer with the Indigenous Environmental Network. My job is a part of the Keep It in the Ground campaign, where I support frontline Indigenous communities who are fighting to protect their homelands from fossil fuel extraction development. Now, some of the communities that we were working with are the Gwich'in and Nupiaq communities up in the North Slope of Alaska, who are trying to fight to protect their homelands from oil and gas development in those regions, who threaten the lives of not only the people there, but also the future of their sacred lands and the ecosystems in which they depend upon, including the sacred porcupine caribou herd in which they get their food. I also work and support communities who are fighting fossil fuel projects like the Keystone XL pipeline, the Line 3, Enbridge Line 3 pipeline, Trans Mountain pipeline, all tar sands pipelines that are coming from the Dene, Cree, and Métis lands of northern Alberta. We also work and support Indigenous communities who are in the Gulf Coast, the United States Gulf Coast region, which is the heart of the United States fossil fuel economy, where much of the oil that is produced in the United States is refined in the Gulf Coast, the United States Gulf Coast, and then exported across the world. My point is saying is that we in the heart of the beast that is the fossil fuel extractive economy understand and feel the pain of so many other relatives across the world. And I want to send my heartfelt energy, just a tremendous amount of love, to our relatives who are acknowledging this historic day and remembering the Ogoni Nine who were executed. For far too long, our people have felt the pain and trauma of state-sanctioned violence. For far too long, our people who are merely just trying to protect their homelands, who are trying to make sure their water is clean, who are trying to make sure that their kids are eating good food, who are trying to protect the future. We've been shot down, we've been executed, we've been persecuted and attacked. And I think the reason for a lot of that is because what we are advocating for, the vision, the things, the world that we are trying to create or protect, is a direct threat to this capitalist machine that is enslaving our people, that is killing our people, that is diminishing the quality of life for our people. And so I stand in solidarity with our relatives overseas who are continuing the work to protect their homelands. And whether it's the fight against SARS or whether it's the fight to defend the movement for Black Lives, or whether it's pushing back against state and sanctioned violence that we're seeing in Europe, whatever it may be, we have to stand united because we are building a world that threatens, that is a direct threat to the colonial system that has occupied our homelands for far too long. And the thing is that this movement is so enticing. It's so beautiful, the work that we're doing, that it's a threat to them and it terrifies the colonial powers that be. It terrifies the state who wishes to suppress our beauty every chance it gets. And so thank you. Thank you for the work that you are doing. Thank you to all the community members, the relatives who are taking to the streets and making sure that their voices are heard, because we're trying to do the very same over here. And so united, let's continue to move forward. Let's continue to share this most beautiful, most enticing story that we can, a story about life, a story that is not about death, that is not defined by the loss of our loved ones, but defined by the power that they brought to us. So thank you so much. Much, much love. Wopida Tanka, Chichi Apido. Thank you in my language. Time over time over time. Thank you.
Kente Gwakia, Niamalina Miawakpun Labukam Masmo Nia Nihiao Kineskumtanawao. My name is Malina Miawapin Labukan Masmo. I come from the Lubicon Cree First Nation, which is an indigenous community that's in the northern part of Canada in Treaty 8 territory. Our territories are in the heart of the Alberta tar sands, which is one of the largest industrial extraction zones in the world. And that's where I was born and raised and grew up in and around these areas. So our community in 1988, when at the age of seven, I was already on my first blockade as our community struggled against the impact of what was happening back home, which is massive logging, oil and gas and fracking. Today we are here because we are thinking of and celebrating, but also memorializing the memory of the Ogoni 9, 25 years ago, who were murdered for speaking out in resistance and protection of their homelands. For me as a young person, I learned about the Ogoni people in Kensarawiwa. As a young person, it inspired me to continue to speak out. I was seven at the beginning, and as I came into my teenage years and into my early 20s, the inspiration of the Ogoni people and their strong resistance against Shell made me realize and know that I also too had to speak out. I too had to not fear all of the oppressive forces that were destroying our homelands. Shell also was in our homelands. Shell has been in our territory since before I was born. And so this is a part of the movement that I have come into. And so my solidarity is with the Ogoni people of Nigeria and with all people that stand against Shell and all industrial extraction companies that refuse to allow our people to have clean air, clean water, to clean air to breathe. We've experienced massive industrial contamination in our territory. So I think a lot about the Ogoni people and the struggle that the people of Nigeria have had to endure for decades and decades and decades, like we as Indigenous people also had to endure here on Turtle Island. So we stand with you. I think of you today. I send you love. I send you my solidarity. I send you my prayers. Our community is also familiar with the hundreds of years of state violence inflicted against our people through cultural and environmental and just straight up genocide. Our people and our communities have been forcibly removed from the land and also forced into intense state schools, which killed the Indian and the child and killed many children and tried to attempt assimilation to kill the culture and our people, but yet we still stand. And as the Ogoni people continue to stand in resistance and the Nigerian people continue to stand against state violence, we stand with you. Over here, we also have an issue of murder and missing Indigenous women, my sister being one of them, and that's something that we still continue to fight against as well. State violence, police violence against frontline land defenders, now women now that are standing against industrial extraction and pipeline infrastructure, women that are still being abused now, limbs being broken, being arrested just to protect our homelands. It's still happening here and now, and I know it's happening over there, so we stand with you. And my mission for the future is one that we can dance the guns to silence, that we can be in our joy, be in our bodies, and not live in fear. I know a lot of trauma has been inflicted upon our people, and I pray for healing justice. I pray for us to live in our joy and full embodiment of the ability to be here now in this joy, in this beauty. And I know it's very difficult. I myself have struggled against that, seeing the beauty amongst all of the injustices. But this connection between us is one that makes me feel hope and joy for the future. And that's what I continue to pray for is justice for our people. Hi, hi, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Melina. And that concludes our frontline reports from CCC TV this evening. And we want to thank you for tuning in. As we said, it's always so crucial to have these capsules of Movement Her Story for us, for ourselves, to envision the future and to remember where we came from, to hold these stories, to hold these testimonies in our hearts when the work gets hard, when we can't see forward. I hope that we can keep that and keep us inspired. It's been such a great evening and I'm so grateful to have spent it with you all. Thank you to Platform and to Shake. I'm gonna be closing out this section and passing on to Laurie. And I just wanted to leave you with a heartfelt invitation to spend some time this evening, this Diwali evening, to call in your ancestors, to spend some time in your body and to make sure that you remember and join us on the next steps. And there'll be some next steps that we'll follow up with you on. We'll be sending out all of the links and all the handles to everyone so you can keep following, keep seeing the calls to action and continue to be a part of this movement. Thanks. Over to you, Laurie.
Hey, thank you so much, Suzanne, for wrapping up the CCC TV show. We are now going to move into some grounding practice with the incredible Tobia de Bajo, but before I introduce them, I would like again to thank all of you for being part of this space, for whatever it took for you to be here tonight and to touch the grace of collective resistance with us. As Suzanne said, this is a beginning. This is a beginning. This is an ongoing wheel. Of collective resistance, and we will stay connected. We're working on a contact sheet that will be sent to all attendees, where all of the links to all the campaigns and fundraisers and websites to all of these exciting initiatives from all of these people, from all of these countries and places, all of that will be sent to you so that you can stay connected to that magic. And without further ado, if it is possible, I'm going to introduce Toby. Toby Adebajo is an anti-disciplinary creator whose practice draws from all the senses and relies upon meaningful collaboration to create work that centralizes diasporic experiences and honors the power of identity at the same time. Toby is gonna help us integrate everything that we have touched and everything that we have learned tonight into our bodies. Over to you, Toby.
Thank you very much, Laurie. Thank you, all the organizers of this amazing event. I'm really grateful to be here. And yeah, as always, just remembering those who we have lost on this journey towards liberation, collective liberation. And as we come to the end of this remembrance, this space of honor, this space of ancestral reverence, let us take a moment to be fully present in and with our bodies, to honor our beings, to ground ourselves in this lifetime, in this existence. We must dance, we must move. And as Ken Sarawiwa said, you must dance your anger and your joys. Dance the military guns to silence. Dance oppressions and injustices to death. Dance the end of Shell's ecological war of 30 years. Dance, my people, for we have seen tomorrow and there is an Ogoni star in the sky. We must move when they try to take it all away from us. They forget that we are the beginning, the end, and everything in between. We are the children of all the ancestors who have paved this way for all of us to enter this space. So let us enter this space together. I will guide you through some EFT tapping mechanisms, and we'll also be playing sounds of the tongue drum
And I hope you can feel comfortable to embody what healing looks and feels like for you in this moment. I hope you're in a comfortable space. I hope you can at least move your hands and your neck. I didn't want to make this too much of a movement heavy practice. So thank you all for being here. Really appreciate it. Really appreciate the space and all the amazing work that has gone into making it happen. So I'm asking everyone to just take a deep breath in. Deep nose. And out through your mouth. And again, in through your nose. And out. Just release all of the tension. Just check in. See where on your body you're holding this tension and let it go. And feel okay in doing that. Feel held, feel supported by the ground, by everywhere, by everything that is holding you up in this moment, in this lifetime, in this existence. And as you do that, I welcome you to take your neck, your head, and look to your left. And bring it back to the center. And look to your right. Bring that back to center and keep breathing. Please breathe. And you raise your head up to the ceiling or the sky, depending on where you are. Back to the center. And looking down to the ground that's holding and supporting us all. And back to the center. I'm going to do this one more time. Just try and stretch your neck as much as possible. Because this spine is the only thing that's holding us up in these bodies. When you're able, if you're able, it's a good time to just check in with your neck and your shoulders and that tension and just let it go. So we're going to go to the left. As we breathe, looking in a different direction. Back to center. Back to the right. Back to the center. Looking up at the ceiling, the sky. Now, as we go further down, center. Keep going as you look to the ground, as you push your neck into the floor. So you're looking at your feet, maybe at your carpet, at your laminate floor. I don't know what's in your surroundings, but you're pushing your neck down and you're breathing and you're releasing that tension from your body. And whenever you're ready, just bring that head right back to the center. As you thank each part of you. Thank you all so much. Hope you're still breathing. Hope you're still relaxing, getting back into your body.
Thank you so much for this, Dobie. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much. And I am gonna take us to the last slide. Slowly and gently. before I do that, I just want to thank every single one of you who participated in making this happen tonight. Every single one who showed up, let's go back. Every single one of you who showed up, the incredible organizing team who's been behind this event from the beginning, from those who put the funding together to those who are here right now today, actually holding this space. I thank every single one of you, you know who you are. And I'm gonna take you to the last slide, which is an invitation to keep fighting. Let's go back. Yeah, we've had some fake starts. But before we go to this final slide, and I will give you the exact signal, Danny. Before we go to this final slide, I just wanna say that this is what we're leaving you. We're leaving you with an invitation to keep fighting, to keep connected to each other, an invitation to keep this work going and to keep touching the grace of our movements, which ultimately is the grace of what we are inside when we allow ourselves to be whole. And the next slide, which we're not playing yet, is a soundscape, again, in Creole. And a short translation of the soundscape's energy is on the slide to help you grasp its meaning. And this is what we're leaving you with today. And now we are going to the next slides. I hope everyone has a good evening.
C'est goumé, faut nous goumé à présent. Mais pas un chéteo, moins quelqu'un veo. Est-ce ou paré? Faut nous goumé, mais pas chieter, moi qui aime, moi qui pote, elle soupare, moi qui aime, moi qui pote, pas chieter, elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumé à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui qu'un verre. Moi qui porte. Elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumé à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui qu'un verre. Elle soupare. Faut nous goumer. Mais pas chieter. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare, moi qui aime, moi qui pote, pas un chieté, elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumé à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui qu'un verre. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. C'est goumé. Faut nous goumé à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui qu'un verre. Elle soupare. Faut nous goumer. Mais pas de chieter, moi qui aime, moi qui pote, elle soupare. Moi qui aime, moi qui pote, pas de chieter, elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui est quimbert. Moi qui est poté. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé. Faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui est quimbert. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Faut nous goumer. Mais pas chieter. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Pas chieter. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui quimbert. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui quimbert. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Faut nous goumer. Mais pas chieter. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Pas un chieter. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé, faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui quimbert. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. C'est goumé. Faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chéter. Moi qui quimbert. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Faut nous goumer. Mais pas chieter. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Elle soupare. Moi qui aime. Moi qui pote. Pas chieter. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare. Elle soupare.
You were yellow.
c'est goumé, faut nous goumer à présent. Mais pas un chitio, moins que Kimber, moins que Potter. Est-ce ou Paris? Est-ce ou Paris? Est-ce ou Paris?